You'd think someone would have thought to take some notes at the dawn of time. Confusion would be totally unnecessary if whoever this first someone was had had a bit of foresight and kept some minutes, so we could all know who, what, when, where, how, and why we are. But the mysteries give us our beautiful confusion, and wonder must be the primary blessing. I mean, time wasn't time until someone thought of it as such. So the dawn of time was the dawn of life in some sense of the word, sensing time passing, right? And therefore, before that, there was no time. Funny is sad, and sad is funny. Words are boxes, and words are box cutters. I can say wholeheartedly, and with all the confidence I can muster, fuck it. And thank good I can, because I only can because I am engaged in the all of it.
Look closely at your dollar bill. Are you looking closely? List and explain at least 10 details of a dollar bill that you've never noticed before. This is 10 details you've never noticed before common to all dollar bills. You have 4 minutes. You missed the instructions.
Tim's grandpa died when he was a teenager, and he shocked all of us, showed up with that chalk drawing of grandpa, so spot on. And then, this is like the year after grandpa died, he wrote a poem called Void. It's very, very touching, and came out of how old was he, 16-year-old? He always wrote. He was in first or second grade, and a little gifted group of language arts students at St. Mary's School in Buffalo Grove. For the school newspaper, it was around Christmas time, he wrote the story of Mary and Jesus and Joseph. And the last line of the story is when Mary turned and said to Joseph, "I'm pregnant." And he looked at her and he said, "That's the best one ever." I couldn't believe the Catholic school would print it. His teacher wrote at the bottom, "Tim wrote this in front of me, no help whatsoever," you know, all perfectly correct with grammar. And to think the thought of, "That's the best one ever," says her boyfriend, her fiance, or whatever he was, Joseph. I thought that was fabulous, and we've saved that story. We went to get our report cards on the last day of school. Everybody's out on the playground, and you go stand by your teacher. And when Tim's teacher handed me his report card, she said to anybody who was around and listening, "I gotta tell you, someday, when Tim becomes president of the United States, I'm gonna say, I had him in first grade." That embarrasses the hell out of Tim if I tell it, because he says, "And here I am, what am I?" And I, you know, you're thinking I was gonna grow up to be president. This would be the last thing I'd ever want you to do.
There always had to be a sense of menace, you know. I never liked music that didn't scare me. I think that was the big split between me and Mike and me and the other Captain Jazz people. Like, my formative band was, I always thought bands were supposed to be scary. I thought that's what a band was, you know.
People always talk about punk rock in terms of conversion, you know, like religious conversion, like Saul in the desert. But that was very real for me. Like, I felt like, oh, do you ever like take a Xanax? Then you're like, oh, I feel normal. This is how everyone feels.
Oh, Tim's a maniac, major ripper, lyrically, musically, you know, it's all from the heart. It's just pure Midwest music, you know.
Yeah, even a couple months ago when he did that video of him dancing around naked, I definitely thought, what the fuck is he thinking? He obviously doesn't give a fuck. But then there's moments where I think he gives such a fuck. I'm constantly perplexed by him.
He just hangs out, he's out every night. A lovely human being. Wouldn't trade him for anybody else in the world.
To be able to do this weird music for this long, the fans of Tim, you know, are fans of what he has to say. He's literally looking in on society because he sort of lives outside of it enough. If you play that game, all these other people are winning anyway, so I'm just gonna live this way and just focus on being as prolific in my arts as I can.
Almost everything he says has like multiple meanings at the same time. And it's usually very funny.
Tim's awesome and misunderstood.
I don't think people realize the scope of the work, and also not that many people are still making work after so many years that's just as good and that's still vital and important and has his own unique perspective on something that we're not getting from anywhere else.
Mumbling little bitch, wimpy piece of shit.
All at once, kind of like super compassionate, like overly sensitive, and also can be an asshole, which is sort of like an oxymoron or something.
We are at my grandma's house. It's her 90th birthday. And there's my grandma, Virginia.
Virge?
Virginia.
Virginia.
See how it says I was a doll?
I'm a good kid, I think. Yeah. I'm not with him too much anymore. He goes out gallivanting with girls.
I'm more curious about what grandma has to say about me as a kid. This is like the place that feels like home to me.
Yeah.
I mean, and this is sort of it. It's like, I don't know. It's not, it's a tiny place. Whatever. I feel like with the internet and 9/11, it's sort of like, maybe everyone thinks the world of their youth was a totally different world, but feels especially true to me. Maybe everyone's own life feels especially true to them. My mom is Italian, my dad is Irish, which is like a very sort of classic Chicago combination of like the cops and the thugs. And you know, my mom was just like endlessly supportive and doting and affectionate, and also endlessly worried and paranoid and bananas. But you know, so there's a vast contrast between the two.
Oh my God, 16 and 18, and I'm letting them go across country, and that was the beginning of it. So yeah, I think I was always supportive. I actually baked a cake for Fugazi. I took them. I went down to U of I to pick up Mike, so he and his friends could come back and watch Fugazi at the rink on the north side, and brought him a nice banana cake. Never got my pan back. Never asked for it back.
Well, my dad was a. My dad grew up on a farm, and he was a packaging machinery salesman. He struggled with drinking a lot. That created a lot of tension in the home. I learned at a very early age, everyone was kind of on edge because of that. You know, it's that thing where things get normalized, so you don't know. You would see like other parents, other families being affectionate or something, and it'd be like, oh, what's, those people are weird, you know? But you don't know that your own life is weird because you're in the middle of it. And he wasn't like a mean person at all. He just like was out of control with this thing. And you learn at a very early age to like
disconnect yourself from, like, this is what I'm seeing, so this is what I think I'm seeing, but this is the other truth that I'm being told. And you learn to sort of like embody that contradiction, sort of come to peace with it, you know? And obviously I didn't know this would be such a formative thing to me, but I in the last few years, I've really realized that was very formative in my sensibilities and my sort of motivations for compulsive creativity over a long period.
Wasn't a gym at the record shop a couple blocks down get you into that particular type of music?
Yeah. I was very blessed to grow up. The only place to like walk to that was interesting was the record store, and then there's another record store like two blocks further away. And I didn't know at the time that that was like a destination for punk rocker kids everywhere. And I became friends with the two guys named Dave, who were like 5 years older than me maybe, but that was like a big deal then. And they would like tell me what records to buy. But that would be the thing that like didn't, that was like my home life versus the friends at school life. So it was like a weird, that was the tension. The way that a bunch of my peers had an ongoing way of dealing with me, not dealing with me, whatever. So I always thought like abuse needed to be an older person, not a younger person or something. Not realizing that power could be, you know, ranked in all kinds of different ways. So it makes perfect sense that then punk rock then becomes this sort of like salvation, you know, because it's like giving voice to rebellion, and I'm feeling like quite literally beaten down and stuff, you know. So I see a therapist, you know, and like after about a year and a half, something came up where I was like telling him about this weird thing that happened to me, and he was like, "Oh, you were abused. You never told me you were abused." And I was like, no, I wasn't abused, man. That was just a weird thing that happened to me." And he's like, "What do you think abuse is, if not that?" And I was like, "No, I wasn't abused." And he's like, "What's abuse?" And I was like, "Oh, abuse would be like if the same exact thing that happened to me happened to someone else." There's a thing, right, when you like are bullied as a kid and you're like singled out. Oh, there's something unique about me, something uniquely wrong about me that makes people want to attack me, you know? What have I done? And it's like, if I can't see it, that's just proof. If I can't see what's wrong with me, that's just proof of how dumb I am and how deserving I am of being bullied. By that time, like, there had been sexual discovery with other people, but it was not positive experiences, you know? And so this is happening at the same time that I like am going through all these rituals of wearing a robe and shaking incense for some creepy old priest and, you know, all the pomp and circumstance of that shit. So like, you know, it's weird. It feels like another world. It has, that sort of shit has nothing in common with like 2016 soundbite world, you know? Orwell 101, man, people are like, need to rewrite their pasts to make sense of their present, you know? And people are very protective of their version of the past, you know? Oh, here's me and Mike in our Batman and Robin underoos holding Batman and Robin.
So, Here's Mike, very happy with his hat and his pony. And Tim comes in and sits behind him and takes the hat. And Mike is not so happy anymore. I just love those pictures.
We're pretty proud of him, the butt butt dance. I'm Mike Kinsella, Tim's little brother, only brother. We were born in Buffalo Grove, Illinois, about 45 minutes northwest of the city. A cul-de-sac block, played outside a lot in the summer. Like totally normal suburban life. And then eventually we found punk rock and started heading to the city more. And then I just followed Tim as he learned more things. So he picked on me a little bit maybe, or that's my view of it. Maybe I instigated it or something. I don't know, looking back. But it was good. I followed him and his friends around a lot. And I don't know if, you know, that's probably pretty annoying. So, but his friends seemed to like me, so I kept hanging out. When they were taking breaks during practice, everybody would just be like shooting baskets or skateboarding in the yard and stuff. I mean, I looked up for him for a long time. I still do, in different ways. We had uniforms and stuff, and we went to church on Friday. But yeah, everybody was. There were some bad kids and stuff. And, yeah.
Oh, Toe Jam t-shirt. Toe Jam had this Iron Cross logo that was a T-O-E-J-A-M, so the O and the A overlapped to make an anarchy symbol. And everyone told us we had to meet this guy, Victor. Victor was supposed to show up to a practice. We hadn't met before, and he never showed up. And we were like, what's up with this guy? And then we like went skateboarding. This Mexican kid is skateboarding, and we like introduce ourselves, and it's Victor. And I was like, man, we're supposed to be in a band together now. Like, and he's like, oh, right, so sorry. His whole thing was like, he took classical guitar lessons. Toe Jam had like 9 different songs that were variations on just the pattern of open E, F, open E, F, open E, F. Then Victor shows up and is like, I don't know, I can play this. And he just plays this D by Randy Rhoads. And we're just like, he's the one that sort of like kick-started all of us. Some of us wanting to just play as fast and wild as possible, and some of us wanting to add technique.
Eventually, it became a release, like an emotional release, you know? That's when it became, like, really serious, you know? You know, we started realizing that this is therapeutic. This is a way for me to fucking play and release this pent-up bullshit I've been, like, you know, carrying around with me for umpteen years.
They were perfect in the sense that they struck a harmonious balance between what I felt was sensitive and vulnerable, but also really tough and punkish and poetic. And it was like, we all wanted to be Rimbaud when we were kids, and it felt like here's somebody writing from that kind of perspective.
So it was my junior year of high school, Captain Jazz started. Me, Sam, and Vic would have all been juniors. Mike would have been a freshman in high school.
Sam had been to every single Toe Jam practice we've ever had. When Toe Jam broke up, Sam was like, I want to play bass. Like, he's like, I want to learn. I really, really want to do it.
And Victor and Sam were in the basement with Mike. They were playing with him, and they were like, he's awesome. We want him in the band. And I was like, no way. If he's in the band, then I'm out. And they're like, all right, then you're out. And I was like, oh, fine, okay, he can be in the band.
He goes out one day and brings back, you know, Sam had, I think, half a shaved head. And Victor shredded already on guitar. It was already a different crowd and stuff, and I was enamored by it. It was cool. They played a variety show in high school, and I was part of writing the song, so I got to leave school early to go play that. I thought that was the coolest thing ever. That's when I sort of got the bug, like, this is fun. You know, like, I get to do cool shit if I'm in this band.
Me, Sam, and Mike, and Victor wanted to, like, be playing a lot more. We were 16, and we were already like, we aren't taking this serious enough. You know, like, we gotta be practicing every day.
It was a lot of playing small towns. We weren't, like, pulling into big cities every night at all. You would get somebody's address in Columbus, Ohio, and, you know, like, you'd be like, oh, cool, we'll set up a show, and you show up there and he'd invite, you know, 50 of his friends. And then you sleep there probably. So you actually like hung out with the people and you got to know like the promoters and it was fun.
I was like a kid calling some club in South Dakota because I heard that they have shows, sending the guy a tape. And we got in some kind of weird situations, but the sense of wonder was overwhelming, you know? This utopian punk ideal. So then Davey joined, and I guess once we were a five-piece, I think the sound got more layered. That's when we really hit our stride.
We were very, very, like, non-vocal about like, writing songs, you know? The songs seemed like they composed themselves, you know? We were able to communicate musically.
Like, it was just such, like, a pure impulse to be doing it. You know, it felt like such like an intense calling or something that it was like, suddenly there was tons of people at the shows, but it wasn't like, oh, we're making it in showbiz.
I do just remember this sort of this energy that just felt very real.
I would kind of assume that he was like a maniac, you know? And the writing was like so unique, like the lyrics were so different. There's just a lot of like intensity behind it.
Well, what really left an impression was Tim busting out his, you know, that French horn. Like he would play it, there's on some of the recordings, and he busted it out and just like play it and freaked out. And I never saw like a live punk band do anything like that at that time. It was different. And weird, and I guess I just gravitate towards that.
I guess I'd describe his voice like, you know, going to the zoo on quaaludes, but all the other animals are on speed or something. From Oh Do I Love You, I don't really know why, I've never really analyzed it, but step on the little fucker's jaw, snap it in half like a wishbone, think to myself like I'm always thinking, was a perfect set of words. And I loved the darkness and even the violence of that image in context to this very sweet song called Oh Do I Love You.
Step on that little fucker's jaw, snap him in half like a wishbone, think to myself like I'm always thinking.
And then think to myself like I'm always thinking. I feel like I could identify so well with that, and it takes you out of the violence of that line. It's more of a glimpse into his own mind, not into his desires or an action that he's ever taken.
This is how it ended in Tokyo.
And also the song Tokyo, he references the theme from Arthur in that song. So all of that was so interesting. I loved spotting those references, and I loved that he was so free with his songwriting.
Always there are entities that really influence nearby entities. Some of these other bands that were so influenced by Cap'n Jazz then become very popular, and looking back in influence, you start to trace things around, and then later on, these other things that weren't as popular at their own time become more popular as time moves forward. You know, certainly Cap'n Jazz sold more records when their records were reissued than when they were initially released by, you know, I don't know the numbers, by lots and lots.
When Cap'n Jazz was like happening, we didn't ever thought of ourselves as an emo band. Maybe they all called us an emo band, but I just thought we were like weirdo punk band. I never felt connected to this scene. It was also like jockish, you know?
Tim did a lot to sort of keep everything together. I think he met those guys and, you know, they're like brothers to him, you know what I mean? So I think he sort of felt like this like need to sort of help them in a way that maybe I didn't. You know, I was just sort of like turned off by it.
There was like an intense schism in the band already at that point, where like Victor and Sam were so fucked up all the time that like they thought I was like a straight edge guy because I didn't like show up to school on acid every day. You know, like, so that was the standard. I mean, it's not like I'm a stern motherfucker. It's just like we're lucky to be able to do this shit.
Tim, he was like the ringleader, you know, or like the father figure.
If someone was to tell me this thing keeps happening to me, and I hate that it keeps happening to me, but it's been happening to me my whole life, if someone said that to me, I would think, okay, you're a crazy person, and obviously these sorts of patterns don't continue unless you somehow want it. Even if you're subconsciously drawing it to you, like somehow you want it. But I swear I have no interest in being like a band dad. I feel so lucky to be able to get away with doing this that like I take it real seriously, you know? I feel like the luckiest guy in the world, so I want to put more effort into it. The more effort I put into it, the like greater returns.
I was pretty out of control. I was very high a lot of times. When I smoked pot, man, I loved the taste of it, and I was so into drugs. You know, Tim knew it. He saw through it, and we were like little giggling like fucking children, you know, like on the stage, you know, like thinking that we could, like we were fooling, you know, Tim and Mike, but they fucking knew what was up. You know, they knew. You know, they knew that we were high.
Everybody kind of had to like make sure his gear was working or he had gear and stuff. And it's sort of like, oh, this would be a lot more cool. Like if you were kind of like pulling your own weight a little bit more. Just seeing somebody with that much talent just sort of have only one interest in like getting fucked up instead of like, man, if you just don't get fucked up, we can do this all the time. And like, it seems obvious when you're not addicted to something to say something like that, but yeah.
You never have a sense of what the dynamics are within a band from the outside. You might see them on a night where it appears that there's this amazing cohesiveness, but you're not sort of in the band between that time. You're not sort of part of all the other things going on. It felt like there was a cohesiveness of them together, and maybe it was that sort of, that energy was really about this, the tension that was internal. So I would say that in that last show that I saw, Captain Jazz, I had no sense that their end was 3 days away.
At some point he was like locked in like rehab and he broke out and we played this last show.
He was just like taking a lot of Ritalin and he took too much, like he was anyways, like that's just what he was doing to get fucked up. But he took too much one night and we were driving through the night.
I hear like Victor kind of like putzing around behind me.
And I noticed Victor like standing up in the back seat and started like pissing all over everything. And I was like, what the fuck? And then we like looked at him and his eyes were all rolled back.
Like the opposite of being cross-eyed. Like, his eyes were, like, here and here. And I remember, like, screaming and waking everyone else up, like, and just, like, being super freaked out because we didn't know what he was on, what he was doing.
I remember having this dream, which probably wasn't a dream, of hearing Tim's screaming, like, just, like at the top of his lungs, like just like, holy fuck, holy fuck, holy fuck, holy shit, oh my God, holy fuck, Vic, hey! Yeah, yeah, just like that, BG. And he was really, really, like, he was really fucking freaked out.
He was like incommunicative and like jittery.
So we drove straight to like the local hospital. And then we waited all day for them to like flush his stomach and pump his stomach. It just scared the shit out of me at that age, you know? It was just like no fun to like see a guy that, you know, you like and you want, you know, you don't know what's going on with him. So we finally got him, he was released to us. You know, like he's gonna still be puking for the next 12 hours, but you can take him. Maybe we drove like half hour or something. We pulled over at like a rest stop or something. I remember like sitting around a bench, like, while Victor's just like still in the van, passed out. And just talking about like, well, what do you guys want to do?
I remember me and Davey wanted to just get a hotel and like wait it out and then just cancel a couple shows and then keep going as a band. But Mike and Sam were the two that were like, I can't deal with this anymore. I don't want to be in this band. So then we like broke up when we drove home from Little Rock, and I just remember like the total silence and heaviness in the van.
Tim might have resented me, like I was saying, he had more empathy for Victor's struggles and stuff. And I was the one, I think, in my memory, who kind of like was like, fuck this, you know, with Cap and Jazz. The details of like breaking up, like we were on a tour and ended up like us having to take Vic to a hospital and spending a day in a hospital. And, you know, that freaked me out. I didn't know if he was gonna die or what, you know, that kind of stuff. I was just like, this isn't fun anymore.
That was like the worst nightmare of my life. They probably saved me, you know, by taking me to the hospital.
We're busy touching to a dizzy stupid.
I never said it, but thanks guys for saving my life.
You know, before anybody heard Black Sabbath, they heard Cap'n Jazz, you know. When you're from Illinois and you're kind of a freak and you don't want to, like, you know, throw a football at somebody 20 yards away, you listen to Cap'n Jazz, you know, that was religion. That's Genesis, Exodus, and Leviticus, man. You know, that's how you start. That's how you get into music, is Cap'n Jazz. There's still kids everywhere, like, Cap'n Jazz is the favorite band of all time. Joan of Arc's the favorite band of all time. For a reason, you know? It's not even like nostalgia, like it was completely relevant today, you know.
Really, really brilliant. I'm realizing the influence that Tim has had in my life. And it's pretty vast. It's pretty vast. It's pretty vast. When the Cap'n Jazz broke up, I think musically we had changed. I think we both kind of were over the balls out, just like screaming and playing hard and playing fast. And so that's like Joan of Arc was, I think, definitely a conscious decision. Like, I'm not going to be in a band like Cap'n Jazz anymore.
Of course, Cap'n Jazz broke up and I had like this incredible vacuum. It's like I still get this like postpartum thing. It's over and it's just sort of like, oh, still me. By the time I was like 22 and I started having to put musician on my taxes, I always felt weird. I'm not a musician, I'm a listener, you know? I love like being surprised.
The second Cap'n Jazz was done, I think he was always headed on his way to that sort of cult status. And I think maybe that informed the music he was making. Maybe he took that approach just to perpetuate that cult status.
There were a lot of people that were just really wanting a more direct continuation. Tim, that wasn't what was gonna move him. He didn't want to do that.
I have like the greatest collaborators in the world. And I feel like I've had the greatest collaborators ever for decades. I feel so blessed, you know? I've learned so much from all of them. I had two bands going. Jade Tree approached me. They're like, hey, start a band and we'll put out the 7-inch. And I was like, well, I got these two bands. Which one do you want? And they're like, I don't know, you know, just make your band and we'll do it. At that point, I just like smashed the two bands together. And it was like, maybe this will be an interesting collision, you know? Limitations so often become virtues. We weren't masters of this shit at all. We all changed instruments. And that was like central to it, you know? Mike was the drummer of Cap'n Jazz and he played guitar in the first Joan of Arc shows. Sam was the bass player of Cap'n Jazz and he played drums at the first Joan of Arc shows and the first records. We just knew in every possible way we wanted to reverse the established expectations. That was really a way to protect the purity of the expression, you know? There needs to be some clumsiness.
We are at Superior Street Studios. We've practiced on and off here 16 years. First time we ever practiced here, Joan of Arc was a very quiet band. June is the anniversary of 20 years from our first show. No one has ever been like, oh, this band is cool because they've been around 20 years. You know, like, that's like longer than Captain Beefheart or Can. We aren't playing up the 20 years thing, doing like greatest hits sets or something. What's more exciting to us is to be a band and it's still finding ways to make it new. Theo Katsionis, Jeremy Boyle, and Melina Asakaitis. Jeremy was in the original lineup first 5 years. There's points on the record where every one of us is playing bass. There's points on the record where every one of us is playing drums. Like, we just totally threw away any sort of roles of I'm the guitar player, you're the bass player, you know? That was super liberating.
He's got a great screaming voice. I mean, he's got a great voice. He did that really, really well. So move on to something new. That makes a lot of sense. And I thought that was a great move.
Tim sort of made them songs by the vocals, you know, like they're sort of vocal heavy. And he wasn't yelling, he was singing kind of in a way he wasn't doing with Cap'n Jazz. It wasn't atonal, it was like every tonal. The thing I like about Joan of Arc, like Tim singing, is like every line you're kind of, you want it to get there. You know what I mean? He's like almost singing, and there's like this like, I like that. It's sort of like, ooh, you kind of like feel it in a way that if a guy can sing, who cares? You know what I mean?
Joan of Arc was really consciously playing with pretty early on, was doing, making music that didn't quite fit properly inside any one specific genre, but just simply kind of give frameworks for hearing the ordinary, the everyday.
Cap'n Jazz sonically was more, you know, straightforward punk in a sense, and then Joan of Arc stripped down and was sort of the antithesis of that, where they would just almost alienate the punk rock fans. And to me, that was almost more punk.
That's real punk anyways, where you're just mixing everything up and doing whatever the fuck you want to do.
Oftentimes, I think you do something and you have to keep doing it. And then it's sort of in reflection, you understand what your intention was.
They're pretentious in all the right ways. I feel like that's one of the beautiful things, is that I can listen to one of their records and in a weird way get in tips and or references or some kind of an education that spans almost every discipline. It's hard to totally pinpoint what kind of music, and that's really beautiful, and that's freedom, and that's real art.
It's scary to say what you really think about stuff and then put it out there. And he's got way bigger balls than I do, at least, or most of the people I know, artists and musicians, as far as like, just like, you know, just saying it and being confident and standing behind it. And even after like a couple of those reviews, a lot of people would have just been like, obviously I'm doing something wrong, like this is fucked up. But not only did he get like, you know, 10 more of them or whatever, but it didn't seem to affect him, his process at all.
You know, you can only push your audience so much. If you're experimenting, then at least deliver the experimentation or the what's supposed to happen as well as you can. I don't think we always knew how to do that. I don't remember anyone liking it in writing, really.
I listened to Live in Chicago, 1999, on repeat. I understand that maybe it didn't get the greatest reviews.
Plenty of people loved it. I loved it. All my friends loved it. And I'm just shocked that it wasn't the record of the year. So I don't think they might have gone through a time when there was not as much support as there should have been. But I don't think they ever had somebody, like everybody say, don't do this. I think he would weirdly enjoy if everybody in the world said, please don't do this. I think that might actually contribute that might fuel more of the fire. I mean, I love the music. I love, love, love the music. And the music is so gentle, so beautiful. It strikes the perfect balance between acoustic instruments and real orchestration and synthetic instruments and, you know, electronic elements. Perfect. But it's the lyrics that really paint that paint a film that are this so cinematic. And even all the indie rock that I was listening to at the time, or all the music, what made Joan of Arc stand out to me was the lyrics. They were, you know, they were funny, and they were
really sad and sweet.
They just started like a new style of music, or they were a moving force of it, obviously. And all the songwriting was completely original, and the instrumentation was super far out, and probably like obscene to do at the time, but they just did it anyways. It was revolutionary in a lot of ways.
Even by the time we record our first record, people were like coming to our shows and being like, whoa, what is this like intense artsy shit? The bad reviews were so intense because they weren't about the music. They were about what a shitty dude I must be. I was getting calls from people writing stories about Pitchfork to ask for comment on what it felt like to be so publicly bullied. You don't just feel that fundamental rejection. You feel that that fundamental rejection validates the bullying when you're a kid. Oh, okay, so I really am this kind of person. I really do have this stink that only I can't smell because I emanate it so profoundly. And so my wife was right to leave me, and these kids were right to pick on me as a kid, and my dad was right to be distant or whatever. You know what I mean? It just like taps into layers and layers. It was surreal. Who is this guy they're talking about, you know?
I remember, so the band was just me, Todd, and Jeremy at the time, and I remember like coming out of the interviews, we were each interviewed separately, and I remember like coming out of the interviews and talking about it and all of us being like, all I talked about was how weird I feel about being in Spin and how lame Spin is. And I was like, me too. And I was like, me too. That was like a funny thing where we realized sort of for the first time, like the greater the circulation of a thing, the like more likely we are to feel misrepresented or awkward about it. Just a lot of anger and frustration in all this stuff. These objects like confirm my memories, you know, and your memories are all impressionistic and you think you remember stuff, but then you're also like, well, I'm sure my memory is weird. But like to see the objects, it's like, no, all this happened.
To me, his lyrics have always been both like social, political, but also very personal, the way that they go like real deep and then they come back up to the surface of politics and social life. We're griping about the things that young dudes might gripe about, feeling, complacency in the culture. So maybe you could say it was like some kind of boredom with a lot of stuff around us.
The reason Tim gets away with it is because he's done it for 20 years. You know what I mean? Like it's not like he's like doing that and then he like throws people a bone like, well, here you go, like I can do this too, you know. And he's never once tried to appease anybody, is what I'm saying. Like, so I, you know, it's sort of like, oh man, that's pretentious. But he's like, oh no, that's how he wants to make music. That's what interests him. And he's obviously doing it for himself, because otherwise he would have done something else. My dad sort of hated selling anything. Like he didn't try to impress anybody or like hated people that tried to impress people and stuff. So I think it was like instilled in us, like, just do what you're gonna do, you know what I mean? And Tim ran with it. I've always just been more drawn to like songs, less than concepts, you know, 60-40 or maybe 75-25, and Tim's been always 75 conceptual and 25 song. I think you can challenge people and also make it listenable, or like, and I think it was kind of, there's like a, it would cross the line sometimes with Joan of Arc in a way that I was like, oh, that's not what I want to do, you know? I don't know if I want to spend 5 hours at band practice playing songs I don't want to play, you know? There's something about, maybe because we're brothers, like the way that we interact, like I'm pretty blunt about what I'm thinking and feeling. We would fight about it. It wasn't very polite. He would win because it's Joan of Arc, you know what I mean? Like maybe, I mean, that's, it's sort of like this unwritten, like you signed the agreement, man. You know, you're here, it's going to be a Joan of Arc song. I don't remember Cap and Jazz butting heads as often. I think like we were on the same page, but we were kind of growing differently after that.
When you can like layer and shade things,
it's like so much more real. When you listen to like commercial radio or classic rock or whatever, and it's like there's still these like intervals that are hundreds of years old that just, if you go from this note to this note, you feel this. You know, it's like covering in, like, it's like playing bingo. Make the listener feel this. Bingo, the fundamental defining thing about being a sentient being is the complexity of layered emotions, you know? Like, there's no just, like, there's no bingo. So, like, music that has, like, all the bingo triggers, it's just, like, such a bummer, you know? Because it feels false, you know?
Joan of Arc has always seemed like a very Chicago-centric band to me, but I can't like put my finger on why, because there's no Chicago sound and there's no Joan of Arc sound. I don't know what makes them inherently such a Chicago band, but they are.
I think the original lab where they poured the formula together to make what Joan of Arc is was Tim and Jeremy. I think that even though Jeremy left kind of early for a real long time, I think, you know, he's integral to the bigger idea of what the band is.
We were always responding to lots of unknowns. I think that allowed, you know, even in the early Joan of Arc years to sort of to be able to comfortably bring in contributors, other voices, other ideas, and sort of let things sort of shift and move.
Joan of Arc, you know, it's gone on hold a couple times. Now it feels good that it's like, now it feels good to know we can put it on hold. Like, when I was away from home 175 days, I remember we were at a gas station in Spain, and I realized we'd be home in a week, and I started crying, and everyone's like, oh my God, what's wrong? I was like, we're gonna be home in a week, and then everyone started crying, like, home, can you imagine, we're going home, you know? So it's like, that was too much. But we also knew that we couldn't just like be like, okay, fuck our band. Like, we were just like, okay, I'll see you around sometime. Like, naturally and slowly, the band became the center of all of our lives. And then it was a very intentional decision to be like, we're all unhappy. All of our lives are a mess. We're like these adults that don't have anything figured out in terms of like how to be adults in the world, you know? So at that point we had to very sort of carefully dismantle and like restructure how we operated. But we didn't want to break up because we knew that we were just sick of each other and we might want to do it again. So we agreed, okay, we'll talk in a year and see if we feel like doing it. And we did. Talked a lot about like how can we be a local band? What would the practice of being a band look like if it didn't involve all this travel?
Hey, Jeremy.
Practice. I got nothing to say about it.
How's it going?
That's kind of how the band just always exists. Total open door policy.
Bobby is like such a solid musician and such a solid songwriter, and he's just like so into it and happy to be taking part of it.
I'm Bobby Berg. I tuned guitars, played tambourine, worked some keyboard in there, played bass in Make Believe, then played bass in Joan of Arc, sometimes guitar.
Just hype man on this one.
Yeah, hype man on this one.
I'll do a dance or something. All right.
I want to help contribute the most important ingredient that I can. And sometimes that means not playing, which that's cool too.
Bobby's role in the band, I think just as his credo in life is to be the most positive being in the room at any given time. And I mean, as far as like keeping everyone's spirits up, as far as like looking to the future, he really does want everyone to have a great time, but he also really wants like for cool things to exist.
I'm looking for notes. I don't even remember what drum beat I played, but okay. I thought it was some sort of tom-oriented thing.
Yeah.
I'm Theo Katsionis. I play drums in Joan of Arc. I've been in the band since 2008 and playing ever since. I think it was maybe like, say, December 2007, Tim called me and he was sort of in a pickle saying, you know, he didn't have any drummers and they were releasing Boo Human in 2008 and they were gonna tour on it, do it East Coast, the West Coast, and Japan. And he wanted to know if I was available, and I was.
We're in the hotel, Moke. Cover tune.
Got that.
Boom.
It's awesome, I think, to have Melina in it, because I think that that gives a different kind of balance to the whole thing. And I really think that that balance kind of warms everything up.
I fucked up that harmony and the meow.
Whenever.
No, but I just have no idea.
You
want to
practice it?
My name is Melina Asakaitis, and I do whatever needs to be done in Joan of Arc, generally. I sing solo stuff, I sing backup with Tim, I help write the lyrics, and I play the fake guitar. It's cool, man. I'm almost 40, and like, this is the most exciting shit that's happened in my life so far.
Okay, you're right.
Yes!
It's almost like we exist as a fucking support group. Everyone's always invited, and the issue is who's in a more popular band that might make more money at the moment, who's moving to New York this year, who is getting married and doesn't want to go on tour, versus who lost their job and wants to go on tour. This was an intentional shift to make the band available to whoever needs it, but not a bummer for anyone feeling like they have to do it, you know? So it's just when circumstances converge.
This is the last practice before the show with the Owl tomorrow night.
And then Japan, where we play twice as many songs as the Owl. It's all right, Kyoto, it'll be great.
There is no place safe, and everything is perfect. There is no place safe, and everything is perfect.
I had 38 songs that I thought were solid, and they fucking sucked. They were so boring. They just sounded like lowest common denominator us. Then we just started jamming, and then we did like, became a challenge to see sort of how long we could jam. Like, could we play 4 hours, constantly switching instruments without stopping, you know? So that's how the new record got made, was these tapping into this whole different way of playing, where everyone played every instrument. None of us can even tell who's, we don't know ourselves who's playing what on what song.
Joan of Arc is working on, he's got This Land Is Your Land in His Hand record. Highly collaborative work.
In thinking about recording the record, we thought, well, what if we record kind of some of the same ideas in different spaces? You know, a space that used to be a studio, a space that was an art gallery at someone's house.
We went into different environments, and that environment and the limitations of that space sort of inspiring the approach. We'd set up stations or like little worlds, like this is the auxiliary percussion station, these are all the synthesizers, these are the drum machines, these are the guitars. But each station was open to each individual member, and someone could just get up from dinner and sit at a drum kit and start making a beat. Or someone could just pick up a guitar and start noodling on something, and then the next person would join. That's a way different approach than making your standard punk rock and roll record that I usually make. So I was there helping them set up the equipment and capture all the early instrumentation and jams that would become the music. And then we started noticing hooks and little pockets of sound that we'd grab and loops that we'd grab from hours and hours of tape. I think the most daunting thing with a project like this is finishing it. I must have been born hanging out. I must have been conceived hanging out. And I know I'm going to die by hanging. I must have been.
We collected all these parts, all this material, all this stuff, and then it's sort of a matter of finding the songs inside, and rather than kind of making the songs.
We're both big fans of Public Enemy and their production team, the Bomb Squad. The sounds those guys used to get and how they used to construct with a lot of weird loops and found sounds and constructing music like that. I think that's a really rewarding way to make something, is to just start with one sound and then just build on top of it. Keep it lit and
keep on looking. Keep it lit and keep on looking. That sonic thing that Public Enemy used to do when they were really good, and the way they combine like intense sonicness with meaning. So then I think the meaning like is something you would get to by listening to it over and over again.
I say we've been less prepared other times for shows.
Yeah, for sure.
The recording will be a closure of one part of the process, which allows us to open up another part of the process, which is kind of figuring out how to now perform some of that music in a live context, where we at sometimes are trying to sort of reach back toward what it was, and sometimes we're just sort of allowing it to really sort of open up and take its own turns.
That sounds cool.
Yeah?
That
is cool.
Yeah, that's great.
This is like really awesome because I still feel like we're making the record.
Right. Peace and conlingus, both give me
heartburn, but I never. Oh, thank you all so much for coming out. Hi, Mike.
Hi.
Hi. We have the best lives, and I hope that you feel the same about your life.
It's really exciting to be working in this current configuration of Joan of Arc. I've never worked, I think, with a group of collaborators where there's quite as much openness as there is between Theo and Bobby and Melina and Tim and I. There is a trust that everyone has in each other that I think is pretty remarkable.
This is our album where everybody has equal say in everything that happens. It kind of like gives everybody the freedom to own the whole thing instead of just like their little part, you know? So it was an experience, and I think that Tim wanted it to be like that, you know? I mean, it's very conceptual in that sense.
What I got out of it was an amazing, like, collaborative experience in a ton of unique spaces with my chosen family, I guess.
I think they're gonna have a ton of fun playing this new kind of music together. I'm actually jealous of it. I wasn't invited to this, but whatever happens directly next, Tim will decide to change it. You know what I mean? Like, if people like this, he's gonna do something else different, so. That's his nature.
Fart noises.
Theo, I love you!
Theo, she loves you. All right, thank you so much. Okay, have a good night.
Thank you.
Theo, love you too!
Be safe, have fun.
All right,
I'm so jealous.
I'm home April 6th. I'll see you April 6th.
It's gonna be four. Fuck off.
Okay, we're in Tokyo. I can no longer call to the full moon for thee.
So I keep having all these very surreal experiences that I don't even like to I had to start seeing a therapist because I had so many strange things happening that I felt I couldn't tell anyone about because it sounds too crazy. Just through crazy convergence of circumstances, I ended up on very short notice going to Neil Young's 70th birthday party, which was a real weird thing because it wasn't a Rock and Roll Hall of Fame kind of giant thing. It was just 100 people, but some friends of mine were like, yeah, man, there's this new vintage store called Kinsella named after you. And I was like, yeah, I'm sure that's a coincidence. You know, that's common name or something, even though I don't think it's that common of a name. So I went and checked it out, and I'm standing outside looking at the sign, and there's lyrics from one of my bands
in the window as like their slogan. And I was like, ah, it's probably still just a coincidence. And I like walked inside and there's like three little pictures of me above the register. And it was like, oh wow, this, okay, I guess I need to like understand this.
You know, I gotta say, I'm so glad it's not like an emo style store, you know? Okay, we're walking to the Kinsella store. I'm doing my biannual inspection to make sure they aren't selling any animal products. It'd be amazing if I shut them down. Hi, how do you do? Yeah. Thank you, thank you. Nice to meet you again. This is Tatsuya Yamagami, owner, proprietor of the Kinsella store. Everyone is My Friend is my least favorite song by Owls. Only, that's one of those songs everyone shouts that they want us to play, but I hate playing it because it's written in a way where I'm not allowed to breathe in between the first line and the last line. So it's like kind of impossible to sing it. But it's one that the audience yells, "Everyone is my friend," which is a nice thing if you're gonna have people yelling something. So I signed the wall, and my brother added the body. Yeah.
That is vintage Joan of Arc t-shirt.
Oh, yeah, very cool. It's Dick Cheney and Mark Twain.
I found that in US thrift store.
Found it in a thrift store?
Yes. Yeah.
I have a standard of buying clothes in which I really only buy things that look like clothes I already own. And I actually don't buy any clothes. I just get my brother's hand-me-downs because he buys a lot of clothes. So he hands me the clothes that look like I already own them. But in my ideal like version of myself, I would dress way cooler.
Yeah. To get a shot of me like throwing my arms in the air, like, "What's my name, Harajuku? Say my name."
Can you use that Kinsella name?
Oh yeah, yeah. Yes. Okay, you can do it.
Yeah.
Okay.
The Supreme store, then lunch, then sound check. Thank you. Thank you. I was doing my old nothing special.
Fuel strut down the street. Arigato.
You know, it's hard to say like 20 years into a band's career they're gonna like take off or something, so I don't see that happening.
Tim's goal for Joan of Arc would be for it to be a sustainable art project. I think he would be happy with that.
I think he just does what he wants to do. I think he would really like people to come around to the way he makes music and the way he creates, but I don't think he's ever gonna stop doing it the way he wants to do it.
I don't make art to make money. I make art so I can keep making art. And I think he makes art so he can keep making art. He works so he can work. No one's trying to make a quick buck. No one's making a quick buck.
Right, you as the reader then have a choice that are you gonna like skip ahead and when you get to the end, you're gonna read 18, 20 footnotes? Are you gonna keep skipping to the end and then back? Either way, it creates a discontinuity.
Tim is kind of a really wonderful example of an interdisciplinary artist who's not going to limit himself to one particular discipline. You've got teaching screenplays, you've got obviously music, passing on the torch, promoting literature and supporting young writers and artists. It's really, really important. In terms of other stuff that he does, there's the putting out his own novels and other people's novels. It's rare that somebody's output is so varied and is still so interesting and fresh. I've never even thought of myself as a musician. And I think Joan of Arc was that kind of example of how to make music where the words are taking center stage. And so for me, that was a huge influence. It felt, oh, okay, that's what I want to do too. God damn it, wrong choice. I don't think I've ever shared how much his music means to me. and how much his work means to me. It means a lot, Tim. I love your work. Thank you for making it.
People that like Joan of Arc or like Tim involved stuff, they love it. It gives them something that they don't find in anything else because it's its own thing in a lot of ways. I mean, it almost sounds like a list of cliches I went through, but that's the case.
I got divorced. It's time for Joan of Arc again. Oh, my dad died. It's time for Joan of Arc again. Those kind of things happen, yeah, happened. Oh, it's George Bush is president. It's time for Joan of Arc again, you know? It's Tim's Joan of Arc.
He's fearless. He's fearless with what he makes. And I think most people are not as fearless as he is. That's what makes his music like so powerful, because he'll just say exactly what's on his mind or do something completely ridiculous where they're like, what? I can't believe you just said that.
No artist should ever wonder, should I make art? Is it of any use? Is it of any help to anybody? That should never even come up. You're asking yourself the wrong question, and it's a ridiculous question. It's like the most important thing you could possibly be doing. What happened?
Me and you in a photo booth, black and white, picture proof.
I think a lot about how much my life is like an ex-junkie for someone who was never actually a junkie. Like, I have real intense disciplines that I stick to every day, mantras I run. I put great effort into being a sort of like joyful, caring, giving, open person, you know? Because I think my default setting is a lot more kind of surly and brooding and obsessive. And I'm so happy when I'm working immersed in any of these things, whether they're like writing or music, just like the making of things, really, I get absorbed in. Joan of Arc is such like a center of a community. It can last 20 years only because we've found this like ideal way of being in which the band serves a function in each of our lives that's totally different than, okay, set your life aside, here comes the band. The band functions only for when people want to do it.
I have like the greatest collaborators in the world. And I feel like I've had the greatest collaborators ever for decades. I feel so blessed, you know? I've learned so much from all of them.
It's funny to think about back then and then think about now. Everybody's disciplined now, you know? Because we've all been through life now.
You don't like end up in this situation without being a weirdo of some kind. And
my bandmates are truly most loving, generous, joyful, creative, daring weirdos I've ever known.